In this video, I'm going to give you all the details that you ever needed to know about the science of sacroiliac joint dysfunction, facet syndrome, as well as disc problems such as herniated discs and bulging discs, and how to differentiate the two, because that is the key. The treatment very often has to match the condition. And what I find in my practice, and by the way, I've been in practice for over 28 years, is many people are getting treatment that would be great, but it's for the wrong condition. So if a person has a sacroiliac joint dysfunction and they're getting treatment and it turns out to be a disc problem, very often they're not getting the appropriate treatment for their condition. So we're going to cover the symptoms that people typically get so you at home can determine or try to figure out which one you have so you can help yourself. We're going to cover how to diagnose these types of conditions. And then also we're going to cover the management of these types of conditions and things that you can do to help yourself get better. So when we're talking about the sacroiliac joint, we're talking about the area between the pelvis and the sacrum. The sacrum is the bottom bone of our spine. It looks like a triangle. And on both sides are the pelvis, the ilium, that attach to the sacrum and form a movable joint. And this joint can be a significant cause of pain for many people. Very often, it's overlooked because in the literature, for many years, it was assumed that the sacroiliac joint was not a movable joint. It later has been determined that there's actually two joints of each area, and that this is a significant cause of pain for many people that can go overlooked in healthcare. Now, a disc, of course, many people know about a disc. A disc is like a little cushion in between the vertebrae, the vertebral bodies, and people liken it or use an analogy that it is very similar to a donut, a jelly donut. So there's an outer layer of the jelly donut, and then inside is a layer of jelly, and if there's tears on the outside of the donut, the jelly can go through and pinch the nerve. That's very much oversimplified, but it's a good analogy to make sure that people can understand what is actually happening. So the symptoms of a sacroiliac joint dysfunction, the first is that pain will often be during ambulation or movement, such as walking. And so if a patient comes to me and says, I have pain in my back when I walk, I will usually ask them to point to where they're experiencing the pain. And almost invariably, they'll point at the sacroiliac joint. And how do you know if you have pain there? Well, sacroiliac joint pain tends to be when you're walking. And if you look at someone's back, no matter how obese or thin they are, of course it's easier to see when someone's thin, there's two little dimples on the area above our waist. And if someone has a tattoo back there, back in my day they used to call it a tramp stamp, the tramp stamp is usually right above those little dimples. And when people wear low-cut jeans, you can actually see the dimples in their back. So that's the area that we're talking about. So patients will often just literally point to the sacroiliac joint and describe it as pain during walking. In contrast to that, a herniated disc, a degenerated disc, will often not hurt that much when a patient is walking. So that's one way that you can differentiate between the two. The second thing is, if a patient says that they feel better, their back actually feels better when they are sitting down. So when they're sitting at work, their back feels better. That's a sign that it's the sacroiliac joint. In contrast to that, the herniated disc will very often hurt worse when a person is sitting down for a long period of time. So there's a term called movie sign. And what that means is you can ask a patient, well, if you go to a movie, what does your back feel like? And if a patient says, oh, I feel great when I'm at the movie, there's your sacroiliac joint. If a patient says, no, my back starts really killing me, I can't even go to the movies anymore because of the pain, then it's more likely a disc. Now, interestingly enough, if you question the patient and you say, now you're at the movies, it hurts. When you go to stand up, what does it feel like? And very often they'll say, it kills me. And that's another thing, in any type of transition, so from a sitting to standing position, if the patient says that they get a catch, or very often elderly people, old people will say, I get a catch in my get along. I always thought that was quite funny when they say that, because it's cute, right? But I understand what they're talking about. They get a knife type of pinching or a catching on one side of their spine in the dimples. That's usually a sign of a sacroiliac joint dysfunction. A disc, not so much. But don't forget that question of, well, how does it feel when you stand up after being in the movies? They're not going to the movies. And of course, the phone rings at lunchtime when I'm trying to do these videos, right? That's just the way it goes. So I'm gonna cut here. Let's transition back into when I'm done with the answering machine, we'll get it. The next symptom that we'll talk about is, how does the condition radiate pain? And radiation of pain is where there's an origin of pain and the pain travels to a certain area. For sacroiliac joint pain, very often the pain will radiate down only one side of the leg, but it will go down in the back of the leg, down through the buttocks, down halfway down the hamstring. That's important. Sacroiliac joint pain very seldom goes past the knee. In contrast, a disc problem, a herniated disc, a bulging disc, will often radiate pain that goes farther past the knee. The patient will often experience pain where there's numbness, tingling, burning, sharp pain that goes down the leg, past the knee, into the calf, into the toes. That's a telltale sign that you have a herniated disc. Very often, the sacroiliac joint will have a dull, achy pain, whereas the herniated disc will have a more severe pain that includes some type of sharpness, tingling, burning, again, down into the toes. That's another clue that you may have a disc herniation. So the last one is actually leading into treatment later on, which we'll discuss in just a couple moments for this video. I will get into the treatment, but this one is key. If you have the patient bend forward to try to touch their toes, very often sacroiliac joint pain, as well as facet syndrome pain, will feel better. The patient will feel some relief. However, when you ask the patient to go and stand up from that bending position, very often there may be a catch in the get along, and that may be a sign that you're dealing with a herniated disc. In bending forward, and this is contrasting that, in bending forward with a herniated disc, very often the patient will bend forward, and I'll tell you, most patients with herniated discs don't get much past 15 degrees. They literally go forward and they're not going much farther. So pain often increases with bending backwards. A sacroiliac joint problem, when the patient is asked to bend backwards, the patient with a sacroiliac joint problem and a facet pain will often say that their pain is worse with backwards bending. In contrast, a disc herniation, very often the symptoms will be slightly relieved, and especially the pain going down the leg will be much less with a herniated disc. So again, if you bend forward and there's pain, it's very likely a disc. If you bend forward and there's less pain, it's very likely sacroiliac or facet syndrome. If you bend backwards and the pain increases, very often the patient will point right to one of those dimples again, and you know it's a sacroiliac or facet pain. If they bend backwards and the pain is relieved, it's very often a disc herniation. So now that you know the common symptoms, let's discuss, how does one officially diagnose these? This is where it gets complicated, and this is where I am of the opinion that if you just listen to the patient, as a doctor, if you just shut your mouth and stop talking and don't rush the patient, they will often give you information that eludes you to what the proper diagnosis is, which is what I just explained to you. But ultimately, if you take an X-ray is really not going to tell us much as to whether you have facet syndrome, sacroiliac joint dysfunction, or a herniated disc. X-rays are largely to see bony structures, and you really can't tell where pain is based on X-ray. There's a lot of false positives and a lot of false negatives, and in the literature, most research has shown that you really cannot predict whether someone's having pain or not based on an X-ray, which brings us into the realm of the CAT scan and the MRI. And for most back injuries, MRIs are more popular because you can see better images of the soft tissue. Now, an MRI very often will find a herniated disc quite easily. A sacroiliac joint problem, unless there's inflammation severe, it's not going to be really easy to diagnose off an MRI. But let's cover this MRI and disc herniation issue right now. The biggest problem with doing an MRI on a patient with low back pain is at a certain age, you're always going to see disc herniations and disc degeneration. The million-dollar question is there a correlation between the disc herniation that you see on the MRI and real life when it comes to the patient? Unfortunately, healthcare is not that easy. It's difficult to look at an MRI and predict where a person has pain. You have to correlate the person's symptoms with the MRI findings. It's not uncommon to have a patient that has pain radiating down their right side along the nerve that is clearly the L5 nerve. You do an MRI and it turns out there's a disc herniation up at L3 on the opposite side, on the left side. So patients will get the MRI results and hear, oh, I have a herniated disc, but clearly the disc herniation does not correlate with the patient's symptoms. Only when we use MRIs can we justifiably send a patient for surgery if and only if the disc herniation correlates well with the symptoms, and then we can put two and two together and really think to ourselves that now we found the problem. There are extreme situations where a person has a disc herniation and it has nothing to do with their symptoms. A good example of that would be a person who's 55 years old, has had chronic back pain, he's been active all his life, maybe he's a smoker, and you do an MRI and he's going to have disc degeneration and herniations all throughout his spine. And it turns out that the doctor wasn't listening to the patient and says, well, Mr. Jones, you have a disc herniation, you're going to have to learn to live with it or have surgery. And it turns out that they actually have a sacroiliac joint dysfunction. This would be the classic example of a patient going to a chiropractor and the chiropractor adjusting the sacroiliac joint. The patient thinks they fixed a disc herniation and the symptoms were never correlated with their MRI. So a complete physical exam is better than just sending people for X-rays and MRIs. One of the best things to do when a patient comes in is to do what's called motion palpation. And this is where the doctor will use their hands to push on the spine and move the spine and try to provoke the spine into movement. If there's a lack of movement at a sacroiliac joint and it correlates with the patient's symptoms, then you found the problem. In addition to that, disc herniations will also restrict range of motion, and you can put people into extension and into flexion and move their spine with your thumb, and that will be a great way to see if you can provoke their symptoms. and get correlation of their symptoms, their exam findings, and then MRI and X-ray can often rule out or rule in things based on the findings. So now let's say that you've been watching this video and now you know you have a sacroiliac joint dysfunction, or you're convinced you have a disc herniation. What are the treatments? Well, number one, the first self-help treatment that you can do, and I have lots of videos on this. If I can remember at the end of the video, I'll put one in a corner of how to self-treat yourself, is to do the McKenzie Protocol. And the McKenzie Protocol is traditionally thought of as an extension protocol. However, it's actually a lot more detailed than that. When you take the courses in how to do McKenzie, it can solve both sacroiliac joint dysfunction as well as disc herniation, but it's most commonly used for disc herniations. Now, how this works is, since we know a disc herniation feels worse when you bend forward, but gets better when you extend, you're going to put the patient into extension, and there's a sequential improvement over time and exercise program that you can do to help your own disc herniation. So you start out real gentle on your elbows, extending your spine for 3 minutes at a time, three times a day. Then what you would do is you can eventually do what I call lazy push-ups, where you're doing the extension presses, and do that for 10 repetitions three times a day. And for a lot of people, that helps. Now, extension may hurt a sacroiliac joint, but the sacroiliac joint can also be helped with McKenzie by learning the position, such as flexion, flexing the spine and flexing the sacroiliac joint into a position where it reduces the pain, is another form of McKenzie. So those are some protocols that are used for disc herniations and sacroiliac joint dysfunction. Now, a sacroiliac joint dysfunction can often be relieved with hip flexor or psoas stretching. So you may find that a position of stretching, where you're stretching your hip flexors, one side will feel better than the other. That's what you want to do. You always want to go into a position of comfort. So if you find that stretching actually helps, particularly hip flexor stretching helps you, then you want to keep at that. Again, doing 10 repetitions three times a day, 30 repetitions a day seems like a lot, but it really isn't when you're trying to solve a problem. These are things that you could do at home for free, and I have lots of videos regarding that. Here's another thing that can be useful, is the sacroiliac joint, even though there's no muscles connecting across the joint, very often the gluteus minimus, the gluteus medius, the quadratus lumborum will often start to harbor trigger points. And when you treat these muscles with trigger point therapy, or digital pressure, you could press into the muscle where it hurts, hold it for about 7 seconds, and then let off, and then stretch the muscle. Very often that will relieve a lot of symptoms that people get with sacroiliac joint pain. And the reason why is because that sacroiliac joint, once it's not moving well, muscles will start to try to take over, and you can get a lot of muscular pain with sacroiliac joint problems as well. Now, for disc problems, the McKenzie 3 exercises, the McKenzie curl, side planks, and bird dog exercises, which again, I have lots of videos on this. In fact, I have an entire playlist. If you know how to find a person's channel, which you're on my channel now, you can go to the playlist section and just type in or use the search function for McGill 3. And those are extremely beneficial exercises for disc herniations. They don't really help that much for sacroiliac joint problems, but they help a lot for disc herniations. The important thing to understand is that for disc herniations, everybody thinks that they need surgery, when in fact only 3% of the people who are diagnosed with disc herniations ever get epidurals or surgery. Epidurals tend to be a temporary fix for a disc herniation, and very often they may last 3 months, they may last 6 months at best. Rarely will you have a patient who has a disc herniation, gets an epidural, and they're good for a year. So the exercising of the sacroiliac joints and, I'm sorry, the discs with the McGill 3 exercises is extremely important. The last thing, and this is going to sound, of course, self-serving because I'm the one that has to do it. This is not something that you can do on your own, but it is beneficial for many patients, is to get adjusted by a good chiropractor. The sacroiliac joint, once it stops moving in certain directions. The sacroiliac joint can move superior or inferior. The sacroiliac joint can move forward or backwards. It can rotate in, it can rotate out. And it really takes a good chiropractor to know how to move the sacroiliac joint in such a way, usually in the position of comfort, that will relieve the patient's symptoms. It takes multiple adjustments to help a sacroiliac joint, but it is a very effective therapy or treatment for sacroiliac joint pain. Now, the difference between that and an adjustment for a disc problem is I find in my practice that an adjustment that moves the vertebrae from posterior to anterior, from back to front, into an extension movement, mimicking the McKenzie exercises, is the best type of adjustment that you can have. Now, let's get into the nitty-gritty about this. This is exactly what I'm talking about, where patients get the wrong treatment for the wrong condition. This is why it's important to find a really good chiropractor, because if the chiropractor is adjusting L5 and you have a sacroiliac joint problem, it's not going to work. Likewise, if you are adjusting the sacroiliac joint and the person has a disc problem, it's not going to work. So these are things where the person has to get proper treatment for the proper condition. So you really want to find a chiropractor that listens to your symptoms, that understands what questions to ask to determine what is going on in the body, do the proper examination procedures that won't give you false positives but can rule out other things and be accurate as to what they're looking for, and then do the proper treatment. But sacroiliac joint problems as well as disc problems can be resolved through natural methods without drugs, without surgery, literally 97 to 100% of the time. Those are the statistics according to the research that's in the literature. And I hope this video has been beneficial for you. I hope you've learned a lot from this video. I hope you've gained insight as to what your condition may be. If you do have questions, you're free to ask questions down below in the comments. I might be able to get to them. We do in our office Zoom consultations and phone consultations, as well as in-house treatment for people. So if you do want to have a phone consultation with me, or you want to do a consultation through Zoom, my information is on my website as well as down below in the description of this video. And as always, I appreciate you for watching my video and my channel. If you like my videos, give me a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and I hope you the best.